Good morning, everyone. So we are going to continue where we left off yesterday. We had looked at the basic model of how charge builds up in the channel area of a MOSFET on application of a positive gate voltage. And now the question is, how do we sort of determine how much will be the current that flows as a result of the charge that has built up in this way? Right. So where we have reached was that we said we have the source and drain terminals. We assume the source is connected to ground. The drain terminal initially we also consider is at ground. There is an insulating layer over here, and then there is the conducting gate contact, the metal, and underneath the gate area, this channel where the p-type substrate starts to look like an n-type material due to accumulation of electrons is formed, right? So this area is the channel, right? Accumulation of electrons converts the p-type substrate to n-type material, and this is called inversion. Okay, so inversion is the main process by which, as a result of the inversion, what has happened is we now have a majority of electrons, which means that the semiconductor material is now in a conducting state, which effectively means now you have two n plus regions, the source and the drain, that are connected together by a conducting material. Okay. From that point onwards, any further increase in the gate voltage, you don't have to worry about the p substrate getting further inverted, you don't need to worry about its Fermi levels and so on in order to find out what is the concentration of electrons. What happens at that point is, it's as if you have a parallel plate capacitor, right? One terminal is the gate terminal, the other is the source and drain, both combined, okay? And what happens to the parallel plate capacitor as the voltage across it increases? Charge accumulates on either plate. Where does the charge come from? In the case of the source and drain terminals, it comes from the N plus regions, which are rich in electrons, okay? Alright, so the next question that came up was, how much is the charge? And what we saw was that Q can be determined as C times delta V, okay? Where the C is given by epsilon oxide into W into L, which is the area of cross section of the area of the capacitor, the area under that gate terminal, divided by the thickness of the, or the distance between the parallel plates, which is the thickness of the oxide. Okay, so this actually, I mean, you know pretty much everything that's over here, right? This epsilon ox number is given by, for silicon, silicon dioxide rather, it is about 3.9 times the permittivity of free space. Okay, so this is the number that we can work with. T-oxide for a 180 nanometer process is approximately 4 nanometers. The thickness in other words is around 4 nanometers. Okay, so you can see that there is a huge difference. 180 nanometers is the minimum feature size we are talking about in this technology, right? In other words, if you want to create a transistor, it is going to be at least 180 nanometers wide. Whereas now we are talking about a thickness which is only 4 nanometers, right? The reason, of course, is that this oxide is something that's grown, so you can control its thickness much more accurately than you can control the width or length of a transistor that you are trying to draw from the bottom, okay? So what are the values for W and L? We will look at that as we go further. They are related to the minimum sizes that you can draw. So in other words, they will be in some way related to 180 nanometers. will there be exactly 180 nanometers or not? There are some restrictions on that which we will see later. Okay. Alright, so that's the C. Then comes the delta V. Right? So what's the delta V? Essentially what we said is it's not just the gate to source voltage. Some part of that voltage has to drop across that insulating material in order to cause the inversion. Right? So that's already been used up. Without that, the inversion layer would not exist. Only the additional voltage in excess of that will contribute to the accumulation of charge. Okay? So whatever got used up in order to create the channel, we just label that as VT. Okay, the threshold voltage. So this is required as a basic minimum for channel formation. Right? And this is a function of various things. It is a function of the materials that are used, the thickness of the oxide, well, maybe partly related at least, presence of ions or charged particles, in the material itself, right? Various other things. Okay. The good thing about it is there are some parts of it which can be controlled by the process engineer, the person who is actually manufacturing all of this. Right? Which means that VT is not just something that you accept. It's not that you know you are just given, okay, this is, you are using silicon, you have a silicon dioxide insulator, you have a metal, therefore this is your VT. It's a bit better than that. You have some amount of control over what the VT can be, mainly by sort of placing some ion implants at strategic locations. Okay? So VT is something that can, to some extent, be controlled by the process engineer, by the process engineer, not by the circuit designer. Okay? So this is always something that you need to keep in mind. This course is about digital IC design. It is not about VLSI process design. Okay. So the assumption is that you have control over certain parts of the thing. As we will see later, the main thing that you as a designer, circuit designer, have control over are the W and L of the transistors, right? The sizes of the transistors. The material, the engineering, the restrictions on what kind of sizes you can use, those are out of your control. Those are all given to you by the process. And you have to learn to work with those in order to achieve whatever you are trying to get to. Okay? So VT in other words is, as far as we are concerned, a constraint that is just given to us. Okay. So what about the delta V? At the source side of the channel, it is going to be equal to VGS minus VT. Okay? Which is the source side, the left side in this figure. The left side in that figure. Okay. At the drain side, it is going to be VGD minus VT, right? Where VGD is the gate to drain voltage, right? The potential difference between gate and drain. Okay. All right. So in some sense, if you want to find out what is the total charge that's there in the channel, one approximate average, assuming that it's going to, you know, just linearly vary from one end to the other, right, which is true as long as the drain voltage is not very large, right, we can sort of write this as average voltage is just the, you know, arithmetic average of the two. So this can be rewritten as VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2. Okay? Where essentially what I have written is VGD is equal to VGS minus VDS. Okay, I'll just replace it with that. So this should be by 2. Okay? Alright, so with this number, essentially what we have is that the Q, the total accumulated charge,
in the channel area is equal to C, which is basically the epsilon ox by T ox into W into L times VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2. Okay?
Alright, so how does that help us? We now know that there is a certain amount of charge that is present in that channel area. We also know that VD in this case is positive, right? We have assumed it implicitly over here, right? I have assumed that VD is positive, VS is 0. So VDS therefore is positive. Okay. When VDS is positive, I expect the current to flow from D to S, from drain to source, right? Which would essentially be caused by electrons, which are negatively charged, moving from source to drain. Okay. So we will just talk in terms of the current flowing from drain to source. We'll call that IDS. Okay, and as a rough estimate at least, one way of looking at this is the charge which is present in the channel area is not changing, the total charge is not changing with time, but some amount of charge is sort of flowing, right? So effectively what we can think about is that there is some transit time associated with this. Any given charged particle, we can sort of think of it as it is flowing with a certain velocity, right? And that velocity is basically going to be given by something which we need to sort of look at now. We need to figure out how to estimate the velocity of the charged particles. Okay? And based on that, we can estimate how much would be the time required for any given particle to cross from one end to the other, from drain to source, or the electrons from source to drain. Okay? So, approximately the transit time for a charged particle is equal to the length divided by the velocity of the charged particle. Length of the channel by velocity of charged particle. Okay. It's equal to L divided by, I'll label it V. Okay. So now we need an estimate for what the V is going to be. How fast are the particles going to move in the channel? Okay. Now, what's happening over here? Essentially, we have charged particles under the influence of an electric field. Okay. And without sort of going into the physics of it, we can sort of say that what ultimately is going to happen is that this velocity, the speed with which the particles move, is going to be proportional to the magnitude of the electric field that is applied. Okay, higher the electric field, the faster the particles move. Okay, normally you know that the force on the electrons is going to be proportional to the electric field, so if there is an electric field, they are going to just accelerate. What's going to happen in practice is that they will accelerate, they will bump into some other nearby particles, they will scatter, once again accelerate, once again bump off, right? Eventually, they settle down to some overall average speed of movement, which it is observed turns out to be pretty much proportional to the electric field, at least as a first order approximation. Okay, so V in this case, we are going to say is equal to some constant mu, right, multiplied by E, where E is the magnitude of the electric field. So what is mu? Mu is the mobility of the electrons, right? How fast do electrons move in silicon under the influence of an electric field, right? It's a little bit more tricky than that. Normally you would be, when we consider mobility and we talk about deriving these equations, we are considering something like a p-n junction, right? This is not exactly a p-n junction. This is a channel which is a very thin layer under the insulating gate. Okay?
So there is a difference between the so-called bulk mobility, how fast electrons move in the bulk silicon under the influence of an electric field, versus the surface mobility, where they are at this interface, right? And the chance of sort of bouncing off things is actually higher. I mean, there is one part of it where they cannot go at all, they cannot go into that insulating layer at all. The overall sort of resistance, well, that's a, not the right term, but the opposition to movement that they see is much higher, okay? Therefore, the surface mobility that the electrons see is typically even lower than the bulk mobility that would otherwise be used in regular junctions, okay? But it's a constant, and we can sort of empirically either derive what the value of the constant should be or at least measure it, and we find that it is then constant as long as the material that we are using remains the same. Okay, alright, what about E? E is essentially to a first order approximation. It is potential difference, it is the gradient of the potential, right? We are assuming that VDS is relatively small. So as a first order approximation, I am just going to assume that the gradient is VDS divided by the distance L. Okay. So now we pretty much have all the paths in place, we can put them together and estimate what the current should be. Okay. So IDS is equal to that charge, which is epsilon ox by T ox into WL into VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2. This charge divided by the transit time, which is given by L, divided by once again VDS by L. Okay. Start cancelling terms out over here. What we finally find is this, there are three L's in the picture, two of them cancel out, one remains in the denominator. So what you get is mu also, L divided by mu into VDS by L, okay. So what we end up with is, these L's cancel out, this L goes into the denominator finally, the mu VDS goes into the numerator, okay. So I combine all the terms finally and write this out as, I am combining constants onto the left side, there is a mu epsilon ox by T ox into W by L. Right, because all the L's after they settle down, finally what you end up with is 1 in the denominator multiplied by VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2 multiplied by VDS. Okay. This equation is essentially what we consider the first order, or sometimes it's called the level 1 equation for the current flowing through a MOSFET. Okay. What are the constants over here, things that we know about the material? The mu, sometimes we also, to be more clear, we can write as mu n, just to indicate that it is the mobility of the n-type particles which matters over here. Okay. There is an electric field which is finally making electrons move. The n-type carriers are the ones that are moving under the influence of the field. In a PMOS transistor, it would be holes that are moving under the influence of the field, and therefore they would have a different mobility. In general, the mobility of the holes would be lower than that of the electrons, especially at reasonably low electric fields. Okay? So mu n and mu d need to be sort of clearly distinguished. In our case, NMOS transistor, mu n. Okay? Epsilon ox, it's a constant, physical constant, right? T ox, process parameter, okay, something that's determined by the engineers who make the system. W and L are two parameters that to some extent are in our control as circuit designers, okay, and they will become very important to us as we move further in this course. VGS, completely in our control. VT,
process parameter. Whoever made the system is finally going to tell you what VT is. VDS again in our control. Okay. So under these conditions, this is a good approximation or a reasonable approximation of what the current through the transistor is going to be like for positive values of VGS and relatively small values of VDS. Okay. Why am I talking about relatively small values? We'll see that in a moment. Okay. So let's see what this implies. What does it actually look like if we start sort of plotting this for, you know, fix a value of VGS and plot this as a function of VDS, for example. Right? For values of VGS which are less than VT, right, this equation does not even hold. Right? Why is that? Because VGS is less than VT, no channel has formed. So all this I derived only after assuming that there was a channel and charge accumulation. If that's not there, then this equation does not hold. What is the current in such a case? Zero, right? There is no channel. It is zero. Okay, we will see that there is actually some concept of subthreshold conduction later, but that's very, very small compared to the currents we are talking about here. Right? So we ignore it. What we say is, for small values of VGS, it's essentially zero. Okay. Now, once VGS goes above a certain value, above VT by a certain value, this whole equation, the VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2, etc., comes into the picture. Right? Now, if you look at this carefully, you will see that there is a overall equation is something of the form something into x minus something into x square. Right? So it's a parabola. In fact, it's an inverted parabola. Right? Something which is rising but slowly flattening out. And then after a while dropping. Okay. So this is what the curve is going to look like. It's going to come up here. Now the tricky thing is, according to this equation, it tells us that after that the current is supposed to drop away. But physically that doesn't make any sense. Right? Why is it that increasing VDS should cause the current to drop? There's no clear reason why such a thing should happen. Okay? And in fact, that is not what happens. In reality, what happens is that once it reaches that sort of the top, the saddle point, right, it just flattens out, becomes a constant. Okay. Physically, what is happening over there is we have a situation here which looks something like this. A positive voltage at the drain terminal, right? The VGD, right, the gate to drain voltage is slowly decreasing, right? At some point, in fact, eventually what happens is that the gate to drain voltage gets to the point where it is no longer sufficient or rather just sufficient to maintain a channel. Okay. So if I look at it, one way of sort of drawing this is to say that as the VGD goes positive, the channel can be seen as going something like this, becoming thinner and thinner and narrower until it pretty much almost vanishes at the drain terminal. Okay. So what does that mean? What happens when the channel vanishes over there? Effectively what it means is that region has once again become depleted. Does it mean that no current can flow over there? No, that's not what it means. What it means is that any free carriers that move in there will just get sucked away very quickly by means of a high electric field that forms in the depletion area. Okay? Current will continue to flow. It's not that the current will just drop away just because the channel disappeared. the channel will cause a regular flow of electrons up to a certain point. They will then reach a depletion region where there is a very large electric field in the US, sort of sweep them away. Okay? They become that depletion region for all practical purposes, sort of becomes part of the drain. Okay. In other words, what actually happens is that at this point, once your BGB has gone to the point where the channel can no longer be maintained at the drain terminal, the current stops increasing. Thereafter, the current just remains constant. Okay?
So this point over here, where the VGD becomes equal to VT,
right?
This is called pinch off.
Okay? And what we say is that the current saturates at this point. It cannot increase any further with further application of VDS. But on the other hand, it does not die away either. It remains there. Whatever current was there at that point can be sustained indefinitely, even if we increase VDS. Okay, it will continue to flow because there is an accumulation of charge under the rest of the channel area as a result of the VGS part of it, or the VGC, gate to channel voltage, which is there in every other part except the region near the drain. Okay? So, the saturation of the current essentially means that as far as this plot is concerned, the current becomes a constant. Okay? All of this falls for one value of VGS. For another value of VGS, I will find a similar curve, one which goes probably even higher before saturating. And if I link up these saturation points, right, what do I expect to see? I find a curve, right, which basically tells me what is the relationship between IDS versus VGS at the saturation point. Okay, the saturation current. So in other words, if I take a large value of VDS, okay, what would the overall value be, right? What does that become? So effectively what we have said is pinch off occurs at VGD equal to VD, right? Or VGS equal to, or VDS equal to VGS minus VD, right? Plug that into our previous equation, this one right here. What we get is, this expression, right? It no longer depends on VDS. What you have said is it has saturated, but it does depend on VGS. The higher the value of VGS, the more effort it will take to cause pinch off. Okay? So this is the so-called saturation equation for the current through the transistor. Okay? So what are the three regions that we can sort of distinguish right now based on this? Effectively what we have is this particular region, we can call the cutoff region, right? There is no channel. This flat region finally we said was the saturation or pinch off, where the channel has stopped at the drain terminal but still exists in the rest of the area under the gate. This third region is usually called either the triode or linear region. This is where we originally derived our current equation. Okay? So these three sections effectively that we have, right? This region out here,
and of course this one over here can be considered the three sort of modes of operation of the transistor. And these are the regions that we are primarily interested in from the point of view of understanding how the transistor works and how to analyze its behavior, analyze the behavior of circuits. Okay? Now, slight digression, but I am going to also sort of give you another way of looking at this, which may be helpful to some of you, but it's not absolutely essential to the understanding of how the transistor works. It is something called a fluid flow model of a transistor, right? It is purely a physical analogy. It has nothing to do with how a transistor actually works, but it's an analogy that sometimes helps to sort of get a better understanding of what are the different modes of operation, what is happening in the different situations, right? So this fluid flow analogy essentially says something like this. Initial condition with all the voltages at zero, right? You can think of a MOSFET as two reservoirs of liquid or water if you want, which are separated by a barrier. Okay? The level of water in both the reservoirs is the same. That's a coincidence in this case, but whatever, it doesn't matter. The level is the same. Okay? The important point is there is no way that water can flow from one side to the other. Okay? But anyway, there was nothing, if the level is the same in both, there is no reason for the water to flow either. So maybe nothing, it's not such a big deal. Okay? What happens when you increase VG, the gate voltage? Increasing the gate voltage is sort of like pressing down that barrier. Okay? The barrier is being pushed downwards. Okay? And effectively at some point what will happen is the barrier will be here, the water will come up to exactly the same level on both sides. This is the threshold. After the threshold, what happens? There is a barrier, but now the water is there on both sides but can also flow across the top. Right? Okay, so all that it means is it's sort of linked up on both sides. Right? Now, what happens when I increase VB, drain voltage? Right? I'm going to consider the drain to be the right hand side and say once again the drain voltage by increasing it, I'm sort of suppressing the level of the right hand side. Okay? This causes a flow of the fluid, in our case electrons, from the source to the drain area, which is the same as a current flowing in opposite direction. Okay? Or you could consider that you could also let down everything around and say the VT was actually increasing the level of one of the reservoirs. Well, no, not really. That causes a bit more confusion. This is a better way of understanding. Okay? But now you can see this. There is a difference between the levels.
you can sort of see that the rate at which the water is going to flow from one side to the other is going to be proportional to the difference between the levels. Right? It's going to be at least related to the difference in the levels that you have. Okay? The greater the gradient, the faster the water will flow. Okay? What happens as the level on the right hand side decreases even further? At some point, this continues to flow, so after all the left hand side remains the same, but it hits this, the barrier itself. And the level over here is even lower than that. Now, the barrier is what is preventing any further increase in the gradient. Right? Whatever flow would happen over there would come up to that barrier, then would just drop over into the right hand side reservoir. Okay? Pushing the right hand side further down doesn't help matters. It's not going to speed things up. The gradient has not increased. There is still flow of water, but it is not going to increase the gradient, it's not going to increase the rate of flow. Okay? This corresponds to pinch off. And saturation in the rate of fluid flow, rate of current. Okay. So, like I said, this is just a physical analogy. It has, with, as is the case with all analogies, you need to be careful how far you take this. It will break at some point because, after all, it is not really modeling a transistor. Okay. But to get a sort of higher level understanding of what causes the electron flow and what is it that saturation in some sense means, this may help to sort of look at it in this way. Okay. So finally, what do we have? VGS less than VT, IDS equal to 0. VGS greater than VT, VDS less than VGS minus VT, IDS is equal to mu n epsilon ox by T ox W by L VDS VGS minus VT minus VDS by 2. Okay, and finally VGS greater than VT and VDS greater than VGS minus VT, IDS equals mu n epsilon ox by T ox W by L into VGS minus VT the whole squared by 2. Okay, the first region is cut off, this is linear and this is saturation. The three modes of operation of a MOS transistor. Okay, now what we are going to do next is to get into what are the sort of non-idealities, the problems that occur with a real transistor. Why is it that the real transistor does not quite behave the way that we derive from these equations? What are the ways in which it deviates from this? And how do we sort of need to understand all that? Okay? So, before we get into that, I want to sort of just very briefly get a flavor for the numbers that we are dealing with. Okay, what are the magnitudes of the values that we are dealing with? Because one of the things which is important for you to sort of build an appreciation for as we go forward in this course is, what kind of numbers are we talking about? Okay. One thing which you should always keep in mind, especially as a designer, but even as someone who's analyzing a circuit, if you ever want to go and, you know, analyze a circuit involving these kind of transistors, and you suddenly come up with a number which says that the current through some particular wire or a particular transistor is 1000 amperes, that should straight away ring an alarm bell for you. Right? I have actually seen answers in the past where people have just blindly done some calculations, punched something into their calculator and written an answer saying the current through this transistor is so many amperes or so many thousands of amperes. Right? The first thing you need to know is that is ridiculous, it's not possible. If you get such an answer, something went wrong. Okay? What are reasonable values that you can get for the voltages across transistors, across terminals, right? And for the currents that can actually flow in such systems. Once you have an idea of that, even if you are not able to solve the numbers exactly, you will be able to get an estimate. And forming such estimates is a very important part of how you can finally do the proper calculations required for deciding how to build your circuit. Okay? So let's take a quick look at what these numbers look like. Okay? Mu n to start it, right? This, like I said, is a parameter dependent on the process. It's for a 180 nanometer process, it is somewhere in the region of 180 centimeter square per volt second, right? Or equivalently 180 into 10 to the minus 4 meter square per volt second. Okay, you will find that very often the units, right? There is a mix of many different kinds of units. So some things will be mentioned in centimeters, some things will be in microns, something will be in nanometers, something will be in angstroms, right? It can get pretty confusing, but the reason for doing that is because people tend to use the most convenient units, right? It's easier to say 180 centimeter square per volt second than to say 180 into 10 to the minus 4 or 128 into 10 to the minus 2 meter square per volt second, right? So we use a number which is sort of easier for us to grasp, that's all. But you need to make sure that you do the conversions properly. Epsilon naught, like I said, 3.9 into 8.85 into 10 to the minus 12 farads per meter. Tox, 4 into 10 to the minus 9 meters. Okay? Let's at least calculate that part of it, right? So the mu n epsilon naught by Tox is something which is a technology constant. That once we calculate it, it's straight away there. It's just something that we keep with us. By the way, this epsilon ox by T ox is usually referred to as C ox, right? Keep in mind that the C ox is not the actual capacitance itself, this is the capacitance per unit area, because the actual capacitance would be this number multiplied by the area. Okay, so the C ox that we are writing about here is per unit area. So the first thing that we need to know is how do I calculate something like this without a calculator, right? Because in a lot of cases, it is actually quite meaningless to even use a calculator for something like this, right? You are trying to form a very quick and rough estimate which tells you, should I choose this size or the next size? Going and punching all these numbers into a calculator is not necessarily helpful, okay? Alright, so first thing, 4 and 3.9 cancel, right? 8.85 is approximately equal to 10, but since I have overestimated that, I will replace this by 160. Okay? This is the kind of approximation that you need to sort of get used to doing, right? You don't have to do it all the time. You are, you know, you can use your calculators if you want to, but for the most part, it is preferable that you sort of get the feel for what these numbers are by doing the hand calculations rather than using a calculator. Alright, let's cancel out the rest of the things. What we have over here is 10 power minus 3. So 10 into 10 power minus 4 into 10 power minus 3, this basically becomes 10 power minus 6. So effectively what we have over here is around 160 microamps. Right? Why am I talking about amps? Because I know that finally this number mu n epsilon ox by tox is going to be multiplied by w by l, which is dimensionless, into some voltage square to give me my current. So the final units are going to be something microamps per volt square. Okay. Let me plug in the rest of the numbers. Typical values of W and L. Right?
To understand this, we need to get a better understanding for how transistors are actually made in silicon, right? But as a first step, what we can say is there is a concept of a so-called minimum size transistor, right? And for the 180 nanometer process that we are going to use, this minimum size transistor, what would we expect it to be? What would we expect W and L to be? 180 and 180 is what we can expect, right? Minimum size, I want both W and L to be as small as possible. Now, L is 180. That's fine. It turns out that W making it also equal to 180 is difficult from a practical point of view, right? It turns out that the way that you actually do layout, you not only need to sort of create the transistor, you also need to be able to sort of implement contacts to the drain and source terminals so that they can be connected to other things, right? And if you want to implement such contacts, then it's not really feasible if those transistors are of width equal to 180 nanometers, okay? So in practice, what ends up happening is that you actually use a width of twice that, 360 nanometers, okay, as the minimum, right? Is this absolutely required? Not really. Like we said, the minimum size that you could get is 180, but that is not a particularly meaningful or useful size, okay? What do we mean by useful? The point is that you will anyway have to use up that much space because you need to implement contacts on the transistors. And making W smaller is not very helpful because it only reduces your current. So in general, we would like to have a larger value of W, okay? Therefore, we sort of settle and say finally the minimum size or the reference transistor as far as this technology is concerned is going to be 360 nanometers in width, okay? So W by L in this case for a minimum size transistor is 2. Okay. What about the VGS, VT, VDS? VT is a technology constant, right? Once again, it has to be sort of just given to you. You use that number without really questioning where it came from. It turns out that for this technology, a commonly used threshold voltage is somewhere in the region of 0.4 volts. We will use that number. Okay? VGS and VDS. VS is typically set to 0. So then it becomes VG and VD. What are the range of values that they can take? Can I apply 5 volts over here? Can I apply 10 volts? Can I apply 15 volts? Can I apply 100 volts? What do you think would be a reasonable amount of voltage to apply across a transistor? Is there a limit? Is there anything preventing me from applying 100 volts as the supply voltage for a transistor? There would be some kind of breakdown, right? You can expect that after these are, we are talking about an oxide which is 4 nanometers thick, right? We are talking about an entire channel which is only 180 nanometers in length, right? So with those kind of materials, if you apply extremely high voltages, the fields that build up are going to be so absurdly high that they will just pretty much burn up your transistor, okay? Now, you may even go up to 100 volts for that. Probably even if you go up to 10 volts, the same thing is going to happen. Okay? So, that's one thing to keep in mind. You cannot apply arbitrary voltages to transistors. Right? In fact, for a 180 nanometer process, the most common supply voltage that was used was 1.8 volts. Why 1.8? Why couldn't I choose 1 volt? Why couldn't I choose half a volt? Why not 0.1 volts? What's wrong with 0.1 volts? Below threshold, so it's not even going to invert the channel. Okay? What about 0.5 volts? It will invert the channel, but just about. There's very little current that you'll be able to pull out of it after that. Okay? So finally 1.8 was chosen as a compromise. It's high enough that I can get decent currents flowing through my transistors, but low enough that it is not going to destroy the transistor. Okay. So VGS, VDS max values are 1.8 volts. Okay. Plug those in there, and pretty much what you will find is, supposing I plug it into the saturation equation, let's say, right? I'll find that VGS minus VT, so 1.8 minus 0.4. The whole square by 2, that's 1.4 square by 2, which is approximately 1. Okay, W by L is 2, that mu Cox is 160. The maximum current that I can expect from this minimum size transistor is somewhere in the region of 300 microamps or so. Okay, so that was just to give a flavor for what are the numbers to look for. Okay, all right, we'll stop here for now. In the next class, we will be continuing with sort of non-linearity with a transistor, but before that, probably on Friday, we will have one session where we are also introduced to the SPICE tools, which you will be using as for all your assignments in future. Okay. One other thing, I believe that the class Moodle site is now up, in the sense that at least all the student enrollment has been done. Okay. So all of you should have access to the site. There is no material on it right now. Please try logging into it. If you are not able to log in, then please send me an email asking and telling me that you have registered for it and that you need to be added to this course. Okay? Okay.